Hey guys, my wife and I tested our blood glucose after 10 different meals, including a Big Mac and fries, and a tub of Ben and Jerry's ice cream to see how each of us responded. Recent research has shown that not everyone reacts in the same way. For example, someone's blood sugar shot up after eating a banana, but not after eating cookies, while for others the opposite was true. First off, a quick explanation about what we're testing. When you eat carbohydrate or a high protein meal, it gets broken down by the body into glucose, which enters the bloodstream. That triggers the release of insulin from the pancreas, which helps shuttle the glucose to your muscle and fat cells. Your body is trying to get the glucose out your bloodstream to return it to its normal range, which for non-diabetics after 8 hours of fasting is between 4 and 6 millimoles per liter. If you are pre-diabetic, your fasted levels will be between 6 and 7, and if you score above 7 after an 8-hour fast, then you're classified as diabetic. Note that I'm talking about type 2 diabetes, which is related to insulin resistance. That is when your body is less responsive to the release of insulin and can't clear the glucose from your blood, so it ends up releasing more and more to deal with the same amount of carbohydrate. If you're insulin resistant, your body releases 5 to 7 times more insulin than someone with a normal response. What we measured is our post-prandial glucose response. Post-prandial just means during or after eating. So we want to see how our blood sugar rises and falls based on different foods. A healthy response is after the rise for it to come down below 7.8 after 2 hours. 2 hours is used because if you are diabetic, that's when blood sugar will peak, while for non-diabetics, it will peak around 30 to 60 minutes after the start of the meal. For the testing, we used a GlucoRX Nexus, which costs 10 to 15 pounds, along with a pack of lancets for pricking your finger and the test strips. To take a measure, you first wash your hands, because if you are handling food, then the residue can affect the reading. Undo the top of the device, pop in a lancet so the grooves line up, take the safety cap off the needle, then put the cap back on. You have 6 depth settings for how deep you want the needle to poke you. We both use 2 out of 6, but if you have thicker skin, it can go up. Then pull the end to set the needle, which will change the colour behind the button. Place it on a finger and press the button, discard the first drop of blood, then insert a test strip into the glucose meter, which should turn it on. Then touch your finger on the end of the test strip where the blood is, and the little bar should fill up, and after 5 seconds it gives you a reading. It can be off by as much as 0.8, but I found 2 readings are usually within half that, so you can still trust any big increases. Okay, onto the fun bit, testing a meal. We tested just before the meal and then every 30 minutes until our numbers came to within about 0.6 of our fasted levels. To get more reliable results, we didn't eat for at least 3 hours before the test meal and we stayed seated until the final reading was taken. First up was oatmeal, which is one of the carb sources people recommend as part of a healthy diet. My fasted glucose starts a bit lower because I exercise regularly and eat well, so mine starts around 4.5 while my wife was at 5. I had a larger portion than her and we both tested a second time adding raisins to the meal. I peaked higher with the raisins and it also remained elevated for longer, which wasn't the case for my wife. After her unusual result with adding raisins in future tests, we used 2 test strips at 30 minutes and took the average. Next we tried white versus brown rice. Both of us had the same response, which was a similar peak for both dishes, but with white rice our glucose remained elevated for longer. That is exactly the response we'd expect because of something called the glycemic index. The glycemic index is the relative ability of a carb-containing food to increase your blood glucose levels measured from a fasted state. Now, their definition of increasing blood glucose is not the peak value here, it's something called the area under the curve, or AUC. When they say relative ability, that is relative to the AUC of pure glucose, which they give a score of 100. So numbers vary a bit based on where you find them, but I have porridge as 55, brown rice as 50, and white rice as 76. A better measure, however, is glycemic load, which takes GI over 100 and multiplies it by the grams of carbohydrates in that food. So the classic example is watermelon, which has a GI score of 72, but because there's only 8 grams of carbohydrate per 100, that means a 100 gram serving of watermelon has a glycemic load of 5.8. far lower than a 100 gram portion of oatmeal, which scores 31.2. That means that while watermelon is sweeter, unless you eat a lot of it, then you're not likely to get a bigger glucose response than you do with oats. What that also means is that with the same food for a larger portion, you're going to get a bigger area under the curve. That is, unless you are carb insensitive. To To know what factors could influence our results, I found a great study where 800 participants ate a variety of foods and logged their results. Among other findings, they noted that 1 in 20 people didn't see an increase in area under the curve as portion size increased, meaning they were defined as carb insensitive. So revisiting those initial measurements and calculating the area under the curve, oatmeal was 15 for me, while the addition of raisins boosted it to 27, and for my wife those values were 27 and 15 respectively. White rice was 18 and brown rice 14 for me, and a huge 39 for my wife and 23 for brown rice. So the next foods I tried were some high GI ones like white bread with marmalade and cornflakes. The large portion of cornflakes gave me my highest AUC of 56, closely followed at 46 by toast and marmalade, and I'll be avoiding both of those meals from now on. The paper also highlighted that the presence of fat in a meal would reduce the blood glucose response, and I tried that first with toast and eggs, then with a Big Mac and fries. There was barely any response from the first, but the McDonald's produced a delayed rise that held for an AUC of 54. My wife chose to repeat her worst meal, which was chicken and white rice, this time adding 80 milliliters of creme fraiche. This was in order to meet the carb to fat ratio that the paper showed blunted the effect. To our surprise, this was very effective, dropping her AUC below 10. She scored 26 for toast and marmalade, 24 for a Big Mac and medium fries, and 22 for a single banana. Our final test was to split a tub of Ben & Jerry's fish food ice cream, which is chocolate ice cream with gooey marshmallow, caramel swirls, and chocolate fish. My glucose took an hour to peak at around 6 and then dropped to 5 for an AUC of 32, very similar to oatmeal and raisins. After rising to 6.9 after 30 minutes, her blood glucose kept going and she registered a staggering 8.8 after an hour. We tested this 3 times and ended with an average of 8.6, and although this came down within the next 30 minutes, her AUC was the highest of either of us at 66. The carbohydrate content of a meal was shown to have a good correlation with area under the curve, but I believe glycemic load will be better. I've plotted our AUC against glycemic load on the x-axis. Technically, adding fat to a meal will reduce the glycemic load. Since I don't know the calculation, I've simply converted the higher fat meals to be represented by an x. If I plot a line of best fit through the lower fat glucose responses, you can see that for a given glycemic load, my wife has a higher AUC, which you'd expect given she's smaller and less active. Meals to the left of our line of best fit created a higher response than expected and are not ideal for us to eat. For my wife, that's ice cream, and for me, it's a large portion of cornflakes or toast and marmalade. It's a bit scary to think how obsessive the marketing has been towards low-fat foods when we've both seen that including fats in a meal has lowered the overall glucose response. It's also concerning that type 2 diabetes continues to rise in both the US and the UK. Obviously, glucose response shouldn't be the only consideration when deciding what to eat, but it's useful to know that there are some foods out there that could cause spikes, and that by adding fat to a meal, it's possible to blunt the effect. Thanks for watching. If you have any other foods you'd like either of us to test, then we're open to suggestions. We'll also be testing our response to the same foods, either consumed after intense exercise or having gone for a walk afterwards, as both of those things are said to help control blood glucose levels. Cheers.